Good afternoon. I'm Zanny Minton Beddoes from The Economist, and I am delighted to welcome you to this conversation about the work of the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovation, which is, I have to say, one of the more extraordinary initiatives to come out of Davos recently. It is easy for many of us to become cynical about what the World Economic Forum can achieve, particularly in this era of populist anger. But this, for me, has been a very powerful example of the concrete achievements that this meeting can have. It was born out of a conversation a year ago by all of my fellow panelists here and many others who are in the audience. It's a concrete initiative between governments, foundations, and the private sector, governments of Norway, Germany, Japan, and India, two of the biggest foundations in the world, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, the Wellcome Trust Foundation, strong support from the world's six biggest pharmaceutical companies, GSK, Merck, Johnson & Johnson, Sanofi, Takeda, and Pfizer. I'm saying this not to make an advertisement for all the individual ones, but to say this really is an initiative that has come together. And they were just telling me before we came on stage, there was a meeting, 1 hour meeting last year, between about, I think you said, 24 people, saying something has to be done. We know, we've learned from SARS, but most recently from Ebola, the extraordinary danger that epidemics pose. We know that they are one of the greatest threats we have. We also know that vaccines can protect against those threats, but we know that there is a challenge getting vaccines into a state of preparedness that they can be used quickly and effectively. There is what we economists call somewhat of a market failure there. And so the public and private sector came together, and over the past year, they went from talking to actually doing. This initiative now has contributions, concrete contributions of $460 million, and I hear from Bill Gates, who I'm sure knows better than anyone, that we have promises of $700 million. So this has been a pretty big achievement, and we're going to spend the next hour talking about what this initiative, CEPI initiative, is going to do, and how it will, quite frankly, change and one of the most important threats we face. So with that introduction, I will quickly introduce the panel. You know all of them, but to my immediate left, going left to right for you, the Prime Minister of Norway, Prime Minister Erna Solberg. Next to her, Jeremy Farrar, the Director of the Wellcome Trust. Next to him, His Excellency Alpha Condé, the President of Guinea. Next to him, Bill Gates, the co-chair of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And last but not least, Andrew Witty, Chief Executive of GlaxoSmithKline. So that is six of the members, or rather five, I'm counting myself, six of the members of the panel and of this coalition. But before we get into the details of the discussion, let's tell you the story of CEPI in a two-minute video.
This one started with a bat,
a tree,
and a boy called Emil.
A life full of wonder.
And a world
to be explored.
Soon after,
he fell sick.
And his family did too.
Disease spread further still.
Uncertainty led to fear.
Epidemics
affect us all.
They affect anyone.
At any time.
They don't care about borders.
Or nations.
They are one of our greatest threats.
And with our dense cities,
easy travel,
and ecological change, they spread faster
and further
than ever before.
Businesses close
and airports shut.
Billions are spent
and loved ones lost.
The sound of a cough
becomes the worst
sound of all.
We've sent people into space,
created incredible structures, and connected the world in ways we never dreamed.
But we're yet
to outsmart epidemics.
We're always a step behind.
Because we don't plan.
We react.
We know vaccines can protect us.
We just need to be better prepared.
So let's
come together.
Let's research
and invest.
Let's save lives.
Let's outsmart epidemics.
So, Prime Minister Sol. Has my microphone gone? Now you can hear me. Prime Minister, let's start with you. We're always a step behind, the video says. We need a plan. You had that conversation a year ago. You needed a plan. Tell us why Norway is supporting it and what the plan is.
Well, first of all, it's because CEPI is growing out of the lessons learned, both from what was good about our response to the Ebola crisis, but also what went wrong, why we didn't respond well enough, and what we lacked in the response. We know that the international response came too late. We know that for the affected country, this was devastating. And a lot of international actors joined forces. We developed a vaccine against Ebola. They made very rapid progress. And just before Christmas, The Lancet published the results of the final test showing that the vaccine gives effective protection. And I think in a way this is truly worth celebrating, because now we know how to respond much faster the next time. But although it was nearly a record-breaking development of a vaccine, it was too late for thousands who lost their lives and livelihoods. It has a devastating effect on economics, on human lives and societies. It's matched only by wars and environmental disasters. If you look at what Guinea, Sierra Leone, and Liberia suffered on economic loss of at least $3 billion as a result of Ebola, and we know that SARS cost $40 billion, and a flu epidemic can cost several hundred billion dollars if it really gets strong and affects. We need to be more aware, and this was what we set out a year ago. We thought it would be better to be prepared, to be ahead, instead of responding afterwards. And in this world, I think taking epidemics seriously, we know that we have problems with antibiotics not functioning anymore, that we get resistance to it. We know that vaccines is a way of handling also known diseases today that might not be vaccinated against today because we think the antibiotics can work it. In the future, they might have to be vaccinated against. There is a need to be much more prepared. And I co-chair the UN Secretary General's Development Goals Advocacy Group, and I think epidemics is undermining all of those 17 goals. And for Norway, you might say Ebola was far away. No, it wasn't. We got one of the doctors back home. We know what it was, and we are a highly developed country. We know how much money we used on one patient and to make sure that it didn't affect the rest. And we know that all of these epidemics move so fast that we were very lucky just getting only one patient. We could have got more, and we got a patient we knew was sick when she left and came to Norway. We knew it. We could isolate it. We can make sure that we were prepared to help her, but that's why it comes out. This is not just for the countries that are developing. This is also for developed countries. It's the same problem.
I think that's an incredibly important point. This is not just foreign assistance, which is something that Norway plays an enormous role in. This is self-interest, too. It's enlightened self-interest. Yeah. Jeremy, let's turn to you. And we've just heard from the Prime Minister the broad background as to why it made sense and makes sense for Norway and other governments to support this. From your perspective, as director of the Wellcome Trust, you've been kind of at the coalface of working in and dealing with epidemics. Give me your sense of what the need is here that CEPI is fulfilling. What concretely does it need to do to be successful?
I think it's, so I speak now as a clinician when I spent the last 20 years or so living in Vietnam and lived through SARS and bird flu and then been very involved in the epidemic since then. It's very difficult to get across to an audience just how frightening it is to be at the epicenter of that. You question your whole professionalism, you question whether you should stay at work, you question whether you should go home to your families. And this is what every healthcare worker feels. And I think when we're pausing here just for a second, I think we should all just reach out and thank those healthcare workers around the world who worked during Ebola, working during Zika now, just to thank them, because they are working in extraordinarily difficult circumstances. They're not protected. We have no vaccines to protect them. and they're doing so, and they make all of our lives slightly safer. I would like to have a world where we never have to ask a healthcare worker in future to go into an epidemic without knowing that they're protected. And CEPI, I think, can achieve this. We should bear in mind that with environment change, climate change, and of course, globalization and travel, what happens in Lagos will affect Davos tomorrow. What happens in New York will happen in Beijing. The world is connected. You will all fly after you leave here at Davos and go to almost every country on the earth within a 12 or 14 hour flight. And yet the world is incredibly vulnerable. If I look to just my own experience over 12 years, SARS, Nipah, bird flu, Zika, Ebola, and ask ourselves, do we have interventions which fit the 21st century? Yes, we have public health, yes, we have hand washing, and yes, we have masks, but we had those in the 19th century. And I think what CEPI is going to go and do, vaccines are not the answer to everything, but it will say that the vaccine space for emerging infections, we will have a vaccine for the most important potential emerging infections, and we will do so by working across governments, philanthropy, and industry, and we will change the paradigm by which we make vaccines for these epidemics.
We will come on to exactly how that will happen a little later in this discussion. I wanted first to turn to His Excellency Alpha Condé, President of Guinea, because I think you, Mr. President, can give us a first-hand account of what was the impact that Ebola had on Guinea. What is the world we are now in that CEPI is trying to improve the position of?
First of all, I'd like to thank all of the people who came to Guinea, Sierra Leone, and all of the healthcare workers who helped us put an end. Some of them lost their lives, others fell ill, so I'd like to thank them. I'd like to thank also the Prime Minister of Norway and CEPI for this initiative. We believe that there are two important reasons for this epidemic. Our healthcare system wasn't up to scratch. 245 doctors for 100,000 people in the US, far, far less in Guinea. And our infrastructure aren't sufficiently developed either. But we really need to focus on our healthcare systems. We need really to promote quality healthcare systems in Africa, and we have support for this. We have support from the Pasteur Institute, from other French institutions, American institutions, to achieve this goal. So that's one important thing, improving healthcare systems. Secondly, community health. Quite often we have NGOs who come who do help, but who aren't familiar with our customs, our traditions. So in the case of Ebola, where you have a cultural impact as well, where there are different ethnic groups involved. It's important to really understand the customs and traditions as well if you're going to be if you're going to be effective. We also need to work on transfer of technology. I've worked with organizations who are working with us, but ultimately it is us who are responsible for our populations. Quite often, we find it's difficult to transmit technology and use of technology to the populations, and difficult to get the message across. So when we work with organizations in the field, quite often we find that they expect us to do the field work in Saint-Conakry in hotels and really don't get familiar with how to transmit their technology or become familiar with real life in our country. So there's work needs to be done there. There's also important work in the area of research. Vaccinations, for example. I took the risk of trying a vaccination. I was told it wasn't 100% safe, but I wanted to go ahead and try it to see that it was safe. It's then been rolled out and has been successful. Now, we know that there are sometimes difficult to encourage companies to do the necessary research, but we need to mobilize this research and we need to increase its effectiveness. If we're going to be honest about this, we need to work in all of these areas. Thank you.
Well, Mr. President, I'd just like to push you on one element of that, which is you have laid out the many aspects of the response that are needed. And you also said that you took, and as you did, you had the vaccine trial in Guinea. What would have happened if you'd had a vaccine in weeks, which is what CEPI is trying to reach? What difference would that have made to the experience that you had with Ebola?
Well, of course, if we'd have had it a lot quicker, then the illness, the epidemic wouldn't have spread as far. The WHO, we feel, didn't react in time. That's a fact, I think. We're very grateful to Médecins Sans Frontières, who did really get into the field quickly. When we did have the vaccine, we first of all vaccinated the doctors and healthcare workers, many volunteers, and they didn't get ill. If we'd have had it earlier, it would have been effective, and it would certainly stop the spread of Ebola, protecting the population. So it would have been extremely important. It would have had a huge effect. We want to see a vaccination that is 100% reliable and 100% financed so that we really can take care of people. And I'm not just talking about Ebola here. I'm talking about other hemorrhagic fever diseases. So thank you very much for asking me that question.
Bill Gates, there you heard it. It would have been there within weeks. You are known as someone who likes concrete numbers and metrics of success. So I'd like to get your sense of, first of all, why did you support this? But secondly, what do you expect and hope that CEPI will achieve?
Well, unfortunately, even though there's a substantial risk of various type of epidemics, there's not a natural marketplace, and there's not a natural incentive for people to build products that anticipate that. It simply wouldn't make sense for the private sector on its own to do this work. And so when we look at this kind of risk, the epidemic risk, you've got to bring governments and foundations together to create the right incentive structure. So the good news is that the ability to make vaccines quickly, it may be possible to get that to be dramatically less than it's been. There's a new approach that is sometimes called DNA RNA vaccines that the part you would change to go after a new disease would be a very small part of it. And so a lot of the work, the safety work, the manufacturing work, you could cut that out. It would be even easier than for flu vaccine today doing this seasonal adaptation that is done on a yearly basis. And so the good news is that if you can get, if you can either predict what the pathogen is going to be and get that stockpiled, that's the ideal. Then you have a very, very quick response. The second best case is if you didn't anticipate the pathogen, then you get, using the private sector capability that these CEPI-funded projects will have helped advance, you'll very quickly go in and say, okay, make a vaccine. We don't know how quickly that can be done, but if we can get it down to a year, that would be very good. Now, every week counts. We have simulations showing that if you can get out in 6 weeks, then even a flu epidemic, which is a very fast-spreading epidemic, you can have a dramatic benefit to. That's not to say we know that we can get down to that kind of a shorter time frame. Flu is one actually we should invest because we know it's there. We should invest in it. I'm sure it'll get done by various actors in a universal vaccine for that. So CEPI is very exciting. You know, it's enough to probably do several of these vaccines and really engage the private sector in a concrete way before the next emergency hits. Nobody really knew which approach should be taken, which diagnostic should be done. There are things that CEPI does not cover. It doesn't cover antiviral drugs or diagnostics. And so there should be follow-on efforts for those things, nor does it cover some of the governance questions like how do you allocate vaccines during a crisis like this. So there are still really important ongoing discussions. on those issues. But I really want to thank the partners who come in. Just in the discussions in the last year, everyone's taken a leap of faith to pull this together. And even in the next year, you know, we'll have the staff, and I think we'll actually bid out a couple of these projects. So this is a substantial step that deals with a problem that can keep you up at night if you think enough about it, which is the world's not really ready for a lot of these epidemics. And Ebola was awful. It could have been even worse. There was even an element of luck that it didn't get into Nigeria in a big way. There was an element of luck that you know, it stopped where it did, and it raised so many questions that we need to be better prepared for next time.
I want to come back in a second and ask you about how big that ambition is, of how far you're going to go. But first, I wanted to bring Andrew in and get your sense from the pharmaceutical industry perspective of what is it that is missing? What is it that you need most that CEPI can help bring to push this forward?
I think what CEPI does for all of the vaccine companies and the six of the companies who joined in to CEPI, I think all feel very much the same way. Planning, prioritization, and a mechanism to essentially create increased capacity in the space of research into these rare, unusual, but potentially deadly pathogenic threats. So if you think about what happens in an epidemic or a pandemic situation, first of all, there's almost no spare capacity in the global vaccine industry. If you walk around any of our vaccine plants, they are running full on. All the lines are busy because the world is growing. There is more and more need for vaccine. So the red phone rings, and it's the WHO saying there's a crisis and we need an Ebola vaccine. Immediately after the WHO rings, a couple of countries start ringing to say, we want this vaccine now. That's an almost impossible situation for a company to try and to react to. So, and it's so disorganized because actually the world doesn't know if there's a vaccine candidate ready. They don't know whether there's any capacity lined up ready to go. The companies aren't anticipating that phone call. And what CEPI starts to do is to take the kind of things where we've had to react in the middle of the battle of the epidemic and take those things back to peacetime so that we can start to resolve these issues, start to say, yes, we're not perfect. We haven't got perfect foresight, but we can more or less estimate that from these 12 potential pathogens, there's a reasonable chance one of them could be the next pandemic. So let's start working on them. It doesn't mean we're going to get everything right, but let's at least start working. How do we start to think about taking vaccine candidates through to the end of phase two so that when a pandemic starts, instead of discussing and debating how to do a phase two trial, we go straight to phase three? Those are the sorts of progress points we can make. Why is that sensible for us? Because at the end of the day, when it really boils down to it, the only people who are going to make a vaccine for the world are the six vaccine manufacturers. And so it's in our interest to make this situation much less stressful, much easier for us to react to without disrupting all of the other day-to-day vaccine manufacturing. Because we were very close, I think, in the three companies who were most advanced in Ebola. If it had indeed got worse, we would have all been put in the very difficult position of saying, do we make Ebola vaccine at scale or do we make rotavirus vaccine or another vaccine? And then the world is making a completely invidious choice, which could have been avoided. And that's why we're so supportive of CEPI, and I think all six companies who are represented here today have worked very, very well to help bring this to fruition.
So CEPI will mean that for a certain number of pathogens, there will be vaccines at the beginning of stage two trials. Now, I guess then for me, the question is, you know, money is not limitless. What is the, and you mentioned this was in some sense self-interest insurance, you're buying insurance. What is the right level of insurance to buy? How many pathogens should you go after, and what should the scale of this be? You're clearly just starting, this is a very big start, but how do you think of that? And Bill Gates, I'm looking at you because I know that you think in these terms. So what, you know, what's the ambition in terms of what's the right number to go after or the right scale of this?
The number of potential pathogens out there is far greater than we're likely to do specific constructs for. So, you know, maybe if we're lucky, we can cover the things that are 50% or 60% of the risk. Flu is kind of a special one that we should just go and do. But even putting that aside, there'll be some predictability. And even the surprising ones will have some may have some relationship, so that you're able to just change the vaccine modestly, particularly with these new platforms. You know, ideally, I think we do 5 or 6. At our current funding level, it's more likely that we'll be able to do 2 or 3. But there are some major actors who will participate in this space, including the UK and the US and China, who, whether they come into CEPI formally or they simply take their programs and make sure that they're complementary, like the US BARDA investments, this endeavor will be bigger than the CEPI organization itself. And I'd say broadly, maybe we will get the 10 or so that I think would be attractive. Once we get the 10, then I think the global health community should have a great debate about, should we do 11 or 12? You know, did it go as quickly as we want? At least we will have exercised the, you know, how do you go to the regulator and what do you do about stockpiles? Things, you wouldn't believe every question that should have been resolved in advance of the Ebola epidemic was not resolved in advance. In fact, we can still sort of debate some of these things about trial design that the CEPI construct will force the dialogue to continue and even to be more prepared.
Prime Minister Solberg.
Well, I think I'd just follow up on the last part there, because besides actually working on concrete vaccines, it's also important to have that discussion on how do we have preparedness for scaling up, how do we have a priority on how we do it. You can do all those discussions that can take lengthy time when the problem arises. You can do it in forefront, you can have a scheme, you can have an international discussion on the priorities that you are making in a crisis like this, because you are already there seeing the problems that will arise. Well, so I think it's important to say, it's a workable, it's an initiative for innovation on vaccines, but it's also a way of having somebody pushing this agenda so that we discuss how we are better prepared in the future. And I think that is needed, because there's so many problems. It's overwhelming in a lot of bodies, also in the World Health Organization, that you should deal with. So maybe there have to be somebody who is advocating and pushing this agenda.
Jeremy. Yeah, it's unusual for me to quote Donald Rumsfeld, but I think he sometimes did frame some things sensibly. You have the known pathogens that Bill was talking about, and you know, for a world not to be prepared for the known pathogens that could cause an epidemic is unacceptable. And that's honestly the situation we're in today. And CEPI will address that issue. But I think CEPI will do far more than that. My hope is it actually catalyzes a new partnership. And in these cynical times, I think a global partnership with the various players in CEPI coming together is actually a real sense of optimism and hope. And I think that's very important. But it will also catalyze the whole technological advance. Bill talked about RNA and DNA technologies for vaccines, of platform approaches, so that we're not reinventing a new vaccine approach every time an unknown pathogen comes. But I think CEPI has to earn you have to earn the right to exist first, and you have to earn respect first. And that's why it's critical that CEPI chooses 1, 2, 3, 4 vaccines, and in the next few years, absolutely delivers on those, including, in my view, finishing the job on Ebola. We have a safe and effective vaccine for Ebola, and we actually have more than one candidate. Johnson & Johnson, GSK, Merck, all have very good candidates. But we don't have a licensed vaccine. That has to be finished. We have to be able to have a licensed vaccine that could be used tomorrow when the inevitable epidemic of Ebola comes back.
So the central focus of CEPI will be getting the vaccines and getting the vaccines to the second stage. But as you've all mentioned, there are things beyond that. There's improving distribution schemes, and then presumably there's also something about streamlining regulatory approval. I mean, isn't part of the problem, or wasn't part of the problem, the difficulty of having the time it takes to get regulatory approval? So, Andrew, let's start with you there. Do you think CEPI can play an important role in these things that are sort of, it's actually outside the lab, if you will?
Yeah, and I think really it's to the point that Bill just made. And what CEPI does is it takes something which historically in between pandemics has been treated as a theoretical debate and makes it very crystallized. So if we're working on a MERS vaccine, we can actually sit down with the regulators right now and say, okay, if we have a MERS vaccine which is based on this platform, what do you want to know to discharge your anxieties of safety and the like and quality? Those debate, it wasn't really about timeline to get regulatory approval. It was having the argument over how do you do, what is the question you are going to ask in the first place? I'll never forget in September of the Ebola pandemic, being in Geneva, listening to global regulatory organizations argue with each other over the heads of the industry and the countries involved, whether or not the trials should be placebo controlled or not. That debate could have and should have happened years in advance. And there should be a pandemic response kit which says, right, we go to phase three with this candidate, we've all agreed this is the basis. Liability the same. We still don't have a practical solution for global deployment of emergency vaccines from a liability point of view. And while some people will say, well, how important is that? The reality is, when you take what will always be, even after CEPI, essentially an extremely accelerated development program, and you deploy in an emergency situation, you will find private sector companies reluctant to embark on an open-ended global liability risk. We all know that. The American government resolved it with the PREP Act years ago, but the rest of the world hasn't moved. Those are the sorts of things which I hope won't be done by CEPI, but in a way, CEPI takes away the excuse not to talk about it, because what CEPI does is it turns the theoretical into real, and then everybody around the real issue has to start to step forward with their resolutions. And I think then you start to deliver something much more comprehensive in terms of pandemic readiness.
So it's at the very least the right people around the table with the right incentives to make sure that before the pandemic hits, you actually have some of this stuff working.
I just want to make one other very slightly more technical point, if I can. If this works the way I think we all hope it works, it's a network. And the way I like to think about CEPI from the manufacturing point of view, it's a network of volunteers, first of all, who volunteer into the network their whatever capability, knowledge that they feel willing to, that's relevant and they feel willing to volunteer. If that works effectively, that creates the most extraordinarily novel open innovation environment. And what we're really potentially buying here is not insurance for the first time, but ultra high quality insurance in a way which we have not been able to do in the past. And I don't think we should lose sight of the novelty of how that network could work together if this plays out the way we hope it does.
Mr. President, let me bring you into the discussion here. What would you we've heard now various different ways in which CEPI will move things forward, particularly in vaccine preparedness. What would you hope that it brings? What would you want it to achieve so that it really changes on the ground the environment you face?
Well, first of all, we'd like better collaboration with the government. Vaccinations, of course, but prevention is even better. Certainly in Africa, if we see epidemics develop, well, that's essentially down to an ineffective health system. So we need to improve the health system, and that can be done through better research. If we take the case of Ebola in Guinea, we weren't quick enough in analyzing the strain to see that it was Ebola. It wasn't until it got to Conakry that we were able to get in touch with the Pasteur Institute and find out actually what it was. It was far too slow, so we need support in that regard. And we need to ensure not only that it is at a high level in densely populated areas, but that it reaches right down out into remote areas as well, so that there can be very quick response throughout the country. So yes, we want better vaccinations, but we believe that with a higher performing health system, it won't then be necessary for people to send us international experts, etc. We would be able to take care of it ourselves on the ground. And that for us is better. Obviously, it's great if people come and help us, but it would be even better if we could do it ourselves within the capability of our own healthcare system. Thank you.
Jeremy, how is CEPI planning to work with agencies on the ground, with the rest of the infrastructure that exists?
Yeah, I think, again, it goes back to one of the strengths of CEPI, and as you can imagine, over the last year, you know, there's been quite heated debate at various times. There's people coming from a very different perspective, but particularly following on from Ebola and what the President just said, countries in West Africa have been involved in all of these discussions. We've been fortunate to have Médecins Sans Frontières as a member of civic society there and often at the front line of the epidemics. And I think all of the partners have absolutely bought into the idea of the technological advances, the regulatory environment that we've heard changing, and the actual making of vaccines. But there's another piece which is, I think, critically important to all of us, and it's not just the foundations. And that is that ultimately CEPI also has to deliver vaccines to the world and make them accessible, independent of people and countries' ability to pay for them. And the public-private partnership, as well as with WHO on board, is absolutely committed to make sure that we make those vaccines available and affordable to everybody that needs them. And that's a core principle of CEPI, which all of us have signed up to.
So that's within CEPI's remit to ensure that?
Wellcome Trust, and I'm sure the Foundation would not be part of this if that were not true.
And from the industry's perspective, Andrew?
Yeah, no, we've made it very clear, so I speak for GSK specifically, that we're engaging in this on a cost coverage basis. So we're not looking at a kind of no gain, no loss basis. It's up to each individual company to think about how it engages. Obviously, it's not for any given company or entity to dictate terms, but certainly from our perspective, we think that's the right basis to go forward. And we're looking forward to activating, essentially. We think there's significant benefit for everybody here. We think it's right for patients. We think it's right for countries. We think it's right to streamline and simplify this space. And as a consequence, it's good for us because it's going to take away the disruption risk for us. And it's going to mean that when the phone does ring, we can say yes, more often than we would otherwise be able to do.
So this is, I mean, as you've now heard in very illuminating detail, an extraordinary initiative, but I would not be doing my job as a skeptical journalist if I didn't ask you about what are the potential risks, what are the potential downsides, what's the danger that this becomes a well-meaning talking shop, but it doesn't actually achieve very much. So Bill Gates, let's start with you. What worries you, if anything, about CEPI actually achieving what it set out to do? Is it that not enough people will cough up? Is it that the admirable partnership here that exists on this stage will break down? Is it that the incentives won't be right? What are the biggest concerns, do you think?
I still think we need to do more about epidemics, and the president talked about investments in high-quality healthcare for normal diseases being a piece of that. Very specialized surveillance, where when you see unusual circumstance, you have sophisticated labs nearby. That there are some initiatives, like one called CHAMPS, that we're working on that will bring a piece of that, but still not cover it fully. So my greatest concern is that if people think, oh, we have CEPI, therefore this epidemic thing, we solved that. Even a straightforward thing like how we get probably Gavi to buy the stockpile, how big the stockpile should be, we haven't worked that out. Now, I think that piece actually will be fairly straightforward because Gavi is amazing, one of the best things we've done, countries, including all the supporters here of CEPI, have been generous enough with Gavi that I think we do have the resources there for the stockpile. The diagnostics will be very important. When you're in an epidemic, the idea of who's infected and who's not infected, if you can't tell, then your whole quarantine thing gets you into these very tough situations. The countries were given very contradictory advice about what to do about quarantine because we didn't have a diagnostic at first. Then when we finally got it, it was still a fairly complex machine that took too long to get the results from. So my main worry, yes, there's still some scientific risk on these new platforms, but my main worry is that the world will still fall short of taking care of epidemic response.
Prime Minister Solberg, how do you share that concern, and how will you make sure that Norway is pushing everyone else to make sure that CEPI is not... The you say, tick, we've done enough now, now we can stop worrying?
Well, we are planning to use our best people on this, to work with CEPI to make sure that we put a focus on finding the good solutions. It might be challenging that maybe there will be other bodies who should have taken more care of that, who have not done that, and they will now take one step even further behind. I think it's important that we also see that there's a responsibility for us all to push this on the World Health Organization's agenda to make sure that, because that's the platform where you can have all the governments, all the health authorities around the world to operate together on how you deal with this when the crisis comes. Because you have to go from step two towards, in fact, use the vaccine, make sure. And then, of course, when there is no need of, if there's not a feeling of emergency, things take often too long time. And that's also a challenge in this. I mean, the regulatory system, yes. We are good at bending all of those regulatory systems when people are dying. But when we are just thinking about the potential of people are dying, then maybe the whole regulatory system will be going too slow. So I think there is that might lead to having an organization and having a work and a cooperation and coalition on this, but not being, not reaching the time limit for the next epidemic, which we should try to do.
Jeremy, how do you maintain that sense of urgency? What is on, you know, what should be and what is on CEPI's to-do list in the next, let's say, year or two?
So CEPI's already, you know, there's a long list of potential pathogens and there's a short list, and CEPI's quite rightly said we're going to focus on some initial pathogens because they may not be the right pathogens to focus on, let's be honest. But what any new organization needs to do is to earn the right to exist. And I think by focusing in the next 1 to 2 years on delivering on those promises that have been made, there's nothing better than getting support than if you're successful. And if we do that in the next 1 to 3 years, I believe, and having watched the history of Gavi's development and the amazing contribution it's made, then the world will really get behind and back it. So I think the biggest, most important thing to do is focus on what it's setting out to achieve transparently and delivering on that. And the greatest risk? The greatest risk is to do what we did after SARS, and that's to forget it and move on.
But the metric, if the metric of success is to find, to bring vaccines for these three pathogens that you've identified, those pathogens, heaven forbid, hopefully will not be the basis of the next epidemic. So it will still be preventative. It will still be, you know, insurance. How will you ensure that you maintain the political momentum to say this is really something we need to keep pushing for when your output is hopefully something that will never be used?
Oh, yes. Can I start by, that's where I have this special interest in the combination of this towards the whole whole change of antibiotics now. Because we need more vaccines because antibiotics will not function in the same way in the future. And, you know, the British government made an estimate that in 2040-50 there will be more people dying because of antibiotics that are not functioning and of the old diseases than there are people dying of cancer. So this is an agenda that will move forward because it interlinks between. If you get the flu, yes, you can do a lot of work and you can work on antibiotics to make sure that people are getting cured, but a lot of people will die if you have more resistant antibiotics. So I think we have to see that this fits into also this big agenda that the UN discussed at a summit in September, and which is going to be an increasing big problem for us.
Jeremy, you were.
Thing that this doesn't directly address is bioterrorism. Intentionally caused epidemics. And so the broader agenda for governments is going to have to include that. In fact, you know, I'll be at the Munich Security Conference next month, and this idea that some of these investments that are made for the diseases that are already out there, the likely case for natural epidemics, and what preparedness would look like for the intentionally caused things, you know, that needs to be discussed. It's very hard to rate the probability of bioterrorism, but, you know, the potential damage is very, very huge. And CEPI, I think appropriately, is not in that space. We've got very finite resources, some of the governments that are in and some that are not in, I'm hoping over the next few years there's some substantial investments.
CEPI will catalyze that in part. Even though it's not in that space itself, it will help frame and catalyze.
Yes,
that broader
and some of these platforms are exactly what you would do if your only goal was to create some protection there. These platforms are very helpful. So the two things relate, but we do not say this is a solution for that.
Jeremy, you wanted to add something.
Yeah, I think what is also critical is, and CEPI has a crucial role in this, and that is to maintain the sense of urgency and be a focal point for some of these discussions. And, you know, as the World Health Organization is strengthening its epidemic preparedness, as the World Bank is playing an increasing role to ensure there's financing, as Gavi is involved, I mean, these players have all been part of this CEPI initiative. So, you know, if we move on after the horrors of what we went through in Ebola, then that would be the greatest mistake. I think this is the chance, having had numerous warnings over the last 12 years and the coming together of many people in this room and around this plenary now, I think this is the moment to change things. And the commitment from Norwegian government, Gates Foundation, industry, Wellcome Trust, etc., has been staggering.
One question that may seem to go back to the beginning of our discussion, but it's one that I think is important, is how do you, and you've all come together, and it's extraordinarily impressive, how do you actually decide which pathogen you're going to go take first? How, when you had that discussion around the table, you've got limited resources, Andrew, how do you choose them?
Well, no, what CEPI does is rely on an independent scientific advisory board. So that, I mean, it's really important to understand that. This isn't the vaccine companies cooking up in a corner with Jeremy and Bill. Let's do what we can do. This is coming much more from an independent scientific advisory group who look at the potential threats, look at the likelihoods, look at the various pathogens which are out there and starts to prioritize those. Then essentially what CEPI will do is issue requests to the world, essentially. You don't have to be a member of CEPI, but, you know, essentially to say to people who've got research capacity in these fields, have you got technology capability which could be put to bear on MERS or on NEPA or on Lassa or whatever it is? And then that's what starts to populate the knowledge base and the research capability, and hopefully we see some significant progress. And I think a lot of really good work was done at the very beginning of this to make sure that there was a really strong independence created around the scientific decision-making and prioritization setting.
And as the last set of questions that I'm going to ask each of you, I'd like you to look forward in and do a little bit of prediction in slightly different ways each. And Andrew, I'm going to start with you. If we meet again, well, we will meet again this time next year, what will you hope CEPI has achieved?
In 1 year? Mm-hmm. I think in 1 year that we would have successfully initiated on at least one, if not two, pathogens, that we would have, life wouldn't be perfect, but we would have got into a rhythm of learning very quickly. So I think we have to be realistic, and one of the things I like about CEPI is we haven't waited for perfection before we've begun. Everybody's gone into this with a sense of optimism, but taking a bit of risk. We're all putting our business models a little bit in play here, and that's required. So we need to learn as we go through this year. What I hope a year from today, we've got work in progress on one or two pathogens, that we're feeling like we're making progress, that we're feeling like we're building scientific synergy somehow in the program, and we're beginning to spin off challenges to organizations, functions outside of CEPI that others have to start responding to, and they indeed start responding because they believe there's some credibility around CEPI.
That's a very concrete to-do list. Bill Gates, I'm going to ask you to look a little further ahead in the crystal ball, 5 years.
Well, with any luck, in a five-year time frame, the initial two or three projects would have had success. That is, we see the correlates that we hope to see, and in many cases, we will have chosen to stockpile those things, and so we will really be ready, particularly if we do complementary work on a diagnostic, can we improve these surveillance networks, we will be far more ready than we are today.
And Mr. President, I'm not going to ask you to look ahead too far, but what is for you the most concrete contribution that CEPI will make in, let's say, a 2 to 3 year framework?
We have possibilities now. We are looking at the possibilities for research in Africa, working with CEPI and African governments. Hopefully we can move forward and see vaccinations no longer rely on foreign laboratories, but on African laboratories who can then produce those vaccines. And we believe that can be a very positive contribution over the next 2 to 3 years. Thank you.
Thank you. Jeremy, I'm going to ask you about the financial side. How big does CEPI need to be? 700 million now, what does it need to be?
I'm happy with 700 million, but if anybody wants to contribute, they're very welcome. A number of governments and obviously other agencies have stepped up. I think 700 million is an enormous starting point, and I think with the focus that we are going to bring in the next few years, that should be able to deliver the initial mission. And I believe that with the success of that, then, like with Gavi, like with Medicines for Malaria, then success will demand future success and more financial resources will come. But I think we've made a phenomenal start.
Prime Minister, the last word is yours. What are your expectations?
Well, my expectation is very simple. We have to be prepared for the next epidemic and the next one after that and the next one after that because they are coming. And we might hope that we will manage to stop it from coming, but we are more people. The nature is playing with us sometimes too, so it changes. So we just have to be prepared. And I think this is, as I said in my early statement, the economic consequences are as devastating for those who are hit as wars and conflicts are. The human suffering, as we saw, is immensely. And it should be, therefore, absolutely not just the countries that are standing behind it now, CEPI now. It should be more countries, more organizations, more focus in the future on the older sides of how epidemic awareness should be better.
Thank you. The stakes are enormously high, but this is a very big step forward. With that, our conversation, I'm afraid, has to come to an end, but I would like to call onto the stage all of the other founding members of CEPI. There were more than the five panelists here for a, if you will, a team photo to mark this occasion. So if you would thank our panelists for the conversation, and those of you come up. Thank you.